I understand that you had great fun in the lab today. I can see amazing work done by teams. The courses have been created. But what I conclude is, more importantly, I think all of you have got a much better level of confidence of handling these things than when you came here. Is that agreeable? Now, you have to use this experience and of course estimate how long it will take for your other colleagues and yourselves to design the course and so on. But what I wanted, for the benefit of all, if one representative of each team can come over here, would all of us like to very quickly see what has been done by that team. One or two people, if they could come here quickly.
So we were a mixed bag. We had two people from a very strong social science humanities background. We had two persons from a sort of IT background, but a little of one with some science background, I mean a background to the background, and one having an arts and an IT background, and so on. So one was from a languages background, linguistics background. So we really had a mixed bag. So it was difficult for us to find a course to which all of us could contribute in a meaningful manner. So when I came down, I had an outline in mind. So I had it in front of me, but it was very clear that other than me and my group, nobody was going to understand anything. So we decided on a common topic, and the common topic is what you see on the screen here. So this course is called Surviving the Monsoon in Mumbai, and each of us decided to break this up, pick up one topic which was related to this, and write a little bit about these sections. So this is what the course now looks like. We thought it would be important to the user, tell the student a little bit about the weather and the geography of this city. Also tell them about the demography, because the monsoons without the people there, or the people without the monsoon in the city, would be a relatively meaningless topic for somebody who is trying to find out about the city or its seasons. Then we also thought that Mumbai, being a very strong and very important commercial hub of the country, it would be appropriate to include economic activities that are directly or indirectly responsible for various activities that take place in the city, and which are affected by the very heavy monsoon showers that the city faces every year. And of course, the breakdowns are famous, so we could not have left those out. And then somebody suggested, okay, we are talking about breakdowns, so why not write a small survival guide? So that is again one small part of this course. And it all started looking a little dreary. It looked a little frightening for most of us. We are going to write mostly about the negative sides. So we thought, why not end with a positive note? And so we decided to write a small section on the brighter side of the monsoon, which of course we didn't get down to writing. We really didn't reach that far. But something interesting happened in the intervening hours. Yesterday afternoon, we recorded a small video. And well, that video was not really related to the monsoon. It was just somebody telling a story. But then we thought, okay, let us see whether this story has a moral to take home, and whether this moral could be related to the topic that we are discussing. And after a little bit of deliberation, we thought, okay, there is, if you are brave, you could attach a moral to that, which you could relate to this course. So we decided to do it. So at the end of this course, there is a small story which was related in that video recording, and which you will see at the end of this course. All right. So on a slightly more serious note, this is what we did. We thought there are two parts which were very important, the weather and the geography. So there is a little bit of a discussion on what kind of weather patterns we have, what temperatures you see through the year, and of course how much rain you see throughout the different through the 12 months of the year.
Where did you get these graphs?
Okay, now these graphs are from a Swedish a meteorological site.
Okay.
So these are in the public domain.
But you had no problem in incorporating it in the
No, that was not a problem. So I'll talk about this at the end of what I'm going to say in a couple of minutes.
Sure.
Because I really want to draw your attention to some things which have bothered me.
Yeah.
So there is some text, there are some graphs, and we can explain a few things about the weather pattern in the city around the year. Then there is something about the geography. So there is a map of the city. There is an aerial view of the city at the peak of the monsoon. And there is some information about the geographical coordinates, the presence of the sea on the west, the creek on the east, and by and large a description of what kind of not the geological but at least the geography, the topographical description. And then in the second half we also write a little bit about what, how the settlements are, what kind of transport network there is, so that it becomes a precursor to what we are going to talk about in terms of which problems occur and why do they occur. So there is also a small quiz. So there is a small quiz here. So you are welcome to take this quiz. So it's, there are two multiple choice questions. Now a word of caution though. A quiz, I believe, should be answerable on the basis of the content that has already been discussed, which may not entirely be the case here. It's slightly off. I mean, if you know what latitudes and longitude mean, then you will be able to answer the first question, but that part is not being explained. So this sort of consistency check is not really complete in this section, but nonetheless, I think given this background, most of you should be able to answer both questions. Basically, I mean, there are few other sections where we describe some commercial activities in the city, economic activities and so on. Then there is something about the risks and dangers that present themselves during the monsoon periods and so on. So what we have done essentially in the first six parts is getting familiar with how to put in a little bit of text, a few diagrams, a few photographs, and also a couple of quizzes and things of that sort. Then there is the brighter side, which is where the story is, and well, there is a video to which we also learned how to add subtitles. Here it goes.
Hi, good afternoon friends, and we are here today to try out the MOOCs platform and see if we can offer any of our current courses using this innovative software. Is it a software? Platform, sorry. Okay. I'm going to be telling you a story that you may have heard when you were children about the fox and the stork. Once upon a time, in a land far away, this was a time when animals were like humans and they could speak like humans as well. So there was a fox and there was a stork and they were very good friends.
So for the want of
one day the fox invited the stork for a dinner.
So clearly the story is not relevant to the topic. But that's not really the entire truth as we suggest in the last part of our course. Thank you.
Thank you.
So that's what you have done.
So great job. But I would like to point out one thing. Did you notice that independent of the relevance of the story or something, the clarity even in a first trial by a person in a well appointed lab and some good people to capture the thing, etc., etc., it's easily, for example, she can actually start giving and recording lectures literally from tomorrow in her own subject. The point is that there are a few things which are not at all very difficult to catch on and carry on with this. I would like one representative from some other team to just showcase, please.
First of all, I would like to thank my team and I would like to introduce them. This is Professor Sri Ramakrishnan, NITTR Chandigarh, and Pradeep Kumar, he is the technical head over there. And there is Saurabh from IIFCR Pune. Professor Vyas is there, is from IEEE Delhi University. That's what we have done. We have tried to make a already created lesson on economics to in a MOOC to convert in a MOOC platform, and we have used diagram, which is the soul of any economics chapter, and we have introduced created certain videos, 2 or 3 videos. I'll show you the videos as well as the courseware. We have used the diagram as well, and in economics we will, if we introduce the economics, we try to give them the theory of demand and show the 3 dimensions, what is the relationship, how much is the relationship, that is the technical part. And I have given the overview of the entire course in this introduction, that is what we are going to be able to cover this in this entire course. Then we have divided, what we have done is, I am giving 1 week lesson plans or the kind of planning which we have for this. This is, there are 2 chapters. First is the production possibility curve, and before that I want to show you this video as well. This is the introductory video giving you the overview of the course which we are going to cover under this microeconomics. It is edited by the Mr. Paramjeet and Pardeep. They did it. Huh? It's buffering, but because we have uploaded it through YouTube, so it takes buffering time. Is there voice demand as a function of price of the concerned commodity, the price of related commodity? We will analyze this theory of demand using 3 dimensions. The first dimension we will be using to explain what is the relationship, which will explain with the help of law of demand. The second dimension would be how much is the relationship, which will explain with the help of elasticity of demand. And you would be knowing that the law of demand is simply a qualitative relationship between price and quantity demanded, whereas elasticity of demand is able to quantify this relationship between price and quantity demanded. The third dimension would be why this is the relationship, why there is an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. We will be explaining it with the help of theories of consumer behavior, in which you will have indifference curve approach and Marshallian utility approach. And then we will come to the behavior of the firm. We will explain the behavior of firm into various markets.
This editing part has been done in
competitive market and non-competitive market, law of variable proportion. And lastly, we will discuss about the theory of cost, which is derived from the production function. So
this is, there is another dimension of it. We have tried to create a video using our laptop, as you were mentioning that you require only the laptop, you record it and you can do it. This we have done. I want to show you this video as well.
There are 2 dimensions to this. One is, just see this video for some time, then I'll try to say something regarding this video. We have done, there was some sound of barking and lions and dog as well. Why we have embedded this video?
You can see how easy it is actually to mix things.
There are 2
and when you do a screen capture, you can play multitude of windows and put things in layers and capture them. Wonderful.
There are 2 aspects of it. One is you make it a little bit interesting so that your student can enjoy it, as we have tried to do it. Second is the worst part, that's why I give it a name, disaster, that they can download it somewhere on their laptop and can do whatever they want to do with your video. Yes. So this is the second part. So
the responsibility on the teacher would be make it more interesting, and our subject, this microeconomics, is very dry. So it is the responsibility of the faculty to make it interesting so that they can take out something out of this lecture. So this is, that's how we have planned, and quizzes and all the discussion form references. And we have given textbook as well over here. You can go to PDFs. We have uploaded some PDF which have been created by us under this NME ICT project. So we have given the link of those. These are the chapters which we have tried to take over here in these 2 weeks. So what I was trying to learn, Professor Pathak, was that we have a huge depository of the digital resources.
Yes.
So the problem which we were facing, how to take it to the MOOC platform. So we try to do it actually,
yes,
how we can do it.
Yes.
So I hope that with the setup and the technical staff, we will be able to do a good job with
perfectly
this.
Perfectly fine.
Thank you very much. Though my creative part was not shown because of the problem of this. Thank you very much.
So, everything that I wanted you to try out, you have actually tried out. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Great job.
These are the quizzes which we have
put. Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Multiple choice questions, yeah, and so on. Okay, check, save. You have used 0 of 2, so you are giving 2 chances.
Yeah.
Okay, okay.
The question 2.
But wasn't it fun? I mean,
yeah, it was fun.
Great.
It was fun, and it was
Could I have the
learning in fun? Rather.
Yeah, that's right. Great job.
Thank you.
Thank you. Could we have the third team, please? Somebody.
So, I would like to just go through the course. I just means the group has decided in the first few minutes what to do, and that was really difficult, as the previous speakers also told. But very soon we have converged that let it should be on the matrix algebra. And the moment we came to matrix algebra, then we have given the assignment to each one of our group members that you have to do this, and at the same time you have been given the instruction that you have to use all the platforms of edX. Means you have to upload the video, you have to upload the PDF, you have to write everything, you have to do, you have to set the question. So in these 3 sections we have given all this platform.
Very good.
And then these 3 groups, they have independently put all those things in this material.
Great.
And then again means my Guruji, means you always refer to Guruji, I also refer my Guruji.
Yeah.
He always says that you are a good manager, you are not a good researcher.
Ah.
So I took the advantage of Jyotsna and Kasim,
ah,
that whatever we are doing, you present. So this whole thing we are adding, and then the editing and presenting part, Jyotsna is our team leader, so she is was doing
so
all
go
those
ahead,
things.
But let us see what you have done.
Yeah. So let us first come to the group member. I would like to introduce my groups. Probably it will not come here. You have to go in the beginning of the course. So just starting from edX. So this is the prerequisite about the course we are narrating, what this course means, and what are the things which we are going to add. And then the course staff who has prepared, so Jyotsna,
okay,
Professor Ojha, Professor Kasim, their CV, their biodata has also
how did
been
you manage
updated.
Such beautiful pictures.
You yeah, that you we have took yesterday in the lab, your lab, and uploaded those pictures.
Very good.
And once you go from this, then this is matrix itself comes like a. Yeah, banner also. No, we have taken the from the source on the images of through the Google. And then I would like to go through the introductory video. So Jyotsna is just going through this. So again, in the introductory video, I have emphasized that the whole task was to learn the edX platform, not to present very thing very exciting.
Please call it SWAM platform.
Yeah.
No more edX.
Yeah. So yeah. SWAM platform. Yeah. Of course, in the video I say that it is SWAM platform.
Correct, correct.
So matrix. Just I would like to go through the video on the course. And why we choose matrix, that I also try to emphasize. Concept of matrix I started from the time of Mahabharata, and the first example what I choose was the Chakravyuh, and Chakravyuh was on the framework of the matrix, and they were very cleverly knowing that if Arjun is there, then he is going to break. So first they have made the Garuda view, And then after some transformation, they made it to Chakravyuh. So when Arjun was away. So this was the example I took from there. Then I took the example from Dhoom 3, where the choreographers designed the Dhoom 3 music and everybody used to dance on that. So that, so everything, say your device on the mobile, the display, whatever you are seeing, all these things use the concept of matrix. So that's why we said that why not popularize these things, and that was in the video also. So can we have the video, please? Students generally know me as SK. It's my personal belief. I myself, Sanjay Kumar from Department of Physics, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi, and I represent Group D. Students generally know me as SK. It's my personal belief that knowledge comes by two ways, either through the compulsion, for which most of us are familiar with, or second, through by interest, the platform which we are going to use right now. I shall insist generally for the second one, that is the latter one. In the next few minutes, I am going to tell the wonderful world of the matrix and its application. Do you know the device in your pocket, the display through which you are seeing me, watching the choreography of Dhoom 3, or the end and opening ceremony of Olympiads, all involves some sort of concept of matrix. And we are going to discuss these things in the course which we have designed for you. Let me briefly tell what we are going to offer you in this course. My colleague, Professor Negi from University of Hyderabad, will introduce the brief history of matrix and its application, which has been used in the past from the ancient time Mahabharata. Later, I shall introduce you the types of matrices and its operation, known as matrix algebra. Sanjeev and Dr. Ojha will expose you with the application. More interesting, he will tell you how to send a secret message to your dearest one without knowing the rest of the world. That in the matrix algebra is known as encryption, that involves the concept of matrix. Later on, Dr. Ojha will bring you in the wonderful world of matrix, where you can use the choreography aspect of the matrix. Lastly, my colleague Ms. Jyotna and Dr. Kasim will bring all these things in a platform by which you will go through this. So let us have fun with matrix on this platform, SWAM. Thank you very much. So after that, we just go for the next, where we have introduced the history aspect. And then we have also taken an example from the Mahabharata episode, which is of B.R. Chopra, episode 82. And we have given the clip reference. We can play the video, but as instructed by Uday, that we have given him the time frame that you should watch this, where the Garuda view is going to change to Chakra view under the certain transformations. So that link we have also given. And then this is the Chakra view, means you can see this use totally the entire concept of the matrix. And if you know from where the enter, so that aspect if you are very familiar, you can enter, otherwise only Abhimanyu was knowing, and Krishna and Pradyumna at that time. So this is the situation which is from the ancient time we are using. Then in the next, we arrange the quizzes for this also, and then you can have this. So this is the aspect that we wanted to learn, how to introduce the things at each and individual level, and they were inserting at their own. It was not that someone is helping, and but of course I should thankful to Vrinda all the time. See, I was asking her how to do this, but anyway. So this is the simple aspect. We have defined the matrix, and then we took this mobile device to record the video and put it on the matrix addition and subtraction also. So this part also we have added and given. So can we play that video? So this is what the hand you are seeing is my own, and the pad whatever you are seeing is given by the IIT, the same logo you can see. So it is on the
A11, A12, A21, A22.
Yeah, taken using the mobile.
The elements of the matrix
in the lab yesterday night, and I have a colleague who has edited and posted and then finally posted to YouTube and give the link, so that everything whatever the edX platform wants, we try to do this and try to explain subsequently on that aspect. Strength platform. So again for this we again introduce the quiz aspect. So every section we have put the quiz. Then Sanjeev has introduced the aspect of the matrix, types of matrices whatever we are going to use, and everything is being demonstrated either by the PDF file or by the video or by the quiz. So every section whenever you go, so you can see this video we have taken from the YouTube, so that you can also play. It is a similar thing whatever I was doing earlier, but now you can see that it is being played like this. So it is resource from the YouTube that we use. So yeah. So then we go to the next part that we use in the matrix in the encryption, and that has been again we have taken a very simple example, and he has Mr. Sanjeev has done this, and he has explained how it has been done, supported by video, supported by quiz, and for all these things whatever the platform we have for the now SWAM, so all these things we have given the example and it was working very fine. Then Dr. Ojha used his choreography aspect, so he has also given his own course on the choreography using all those things followed by the video and how it is going to be used. And finally, as I said, Jyotsna and Dr. Kashim, they arranged it, and they were all the time asking me, you have to see because you have to tell. So and all the time I was scared that anyway. So there are a lot of examples, means he has also developed an example of rotation matrix supported by the video and all those things. So I have no problem, means as you said that of course I used to be mess in any of this type of gathering, but I used to be the safest person whenever I am going to implement it. So that is why my concern is. So thank you very much.
Anyway, let's give them a big hand. I think they have run well. Thank you so much.
So this is the team that we have here, and we thought about a topic on supply chain management while we were recording the video, and so I had my colleague prepare the video on supply chain management, and then we thought about how we'll go about designing the course. So as far as the platform is concerned, we started by looking at the course details about the courses, and this is the theme that we have. So we added a short description about the course here, and we gave a link for a textbook which is an open source textbook on supply chain management here. So in the video itself we added a couple of slides about the concept and how the introduction to the course is all about. And then we added some sequence of quizzes and some assignments to make it complete. We had quite a lot of learning from the other teams as well. There were certain things which we were learning. So it was quite interactive in between teams as well. So this is the introduction, a short introduction about the what the course is about, which is a sequence to the video which we have. This is the
welcome everybody.
Can we have the volume?
We will be talking about introduction to supply chain management. Now we have been hearing a lot about supply chains these days, but what is supply chain management? Now 20 years back, 20 or 30 years back, you had individual firms competing with other individual firms, but nowadays you will see supply chains of firms competing with supply chains of other competing firms. So let's look at the definition of supply chain management. So supply chain management can be thought about as a set of approaches or processes that is used to efficiently integrate your suppliers, your manufacturers, your distributors, your retailers, and finally your customers. And in any supply chain that you take, there would be mainly two trade-offs. One is you have to minimize the system-wide costs, and at the same time you have to maximize your customer service level. Now many times people use supply chain management and logistics management interchangeably, but the question is, are they synonymous? I would say logistics management is just a part of supply chain management. So what is logistics management? Logistics management talks about the storage and transfer or distribution of materials within a supply chain. Whereas supply chain management as a whole is much more strategic. So there you talk about supplier selection, vendor selection criteria, you talk about supplier contracts. So that's more strategic in nature. Whereas logistics management is just a subpart of supply chain management. So as you can see in the slide,
yeah, we did some changes and we integrated.
Logistics is concerned with the move.
And this is a small video to illustrate the concept live for a real company. It's a video on Walmart, which we took from the open source Google. Then we have a set of multiple choice questions which we've built in for the students. And we added some details with regard to the course scheduling. And we added some also details with regard to the grading that we have decided on the course for them. So that is what we had. Thank you.
I must admit that when I designed this short workshop, I was in a dilemma, because you will clearly agree that if you have to do a comprehensive study of all features and how to use them, you would require a, first of all, a very methodically defined thing, a whole lot of content pre-created, lessons planned, and 5 full days of activity is minimally what is required. But we didn't have the luxury. So in 3 days, I thought the best is to try out the baptisma by fire, a jump into the ocean. And since this is a very peculiar ocean in which we will never drown, we will remain alive always. And I thought making it interesting by breaking people into. So do you agree that the purpose or the objective is achieved? That now we appreciate that. In fact, I am so encouraged by this that even in any workshop that I will plan, in actual workshop also I will try to do this. They're keeping some sessions where they just play around in small groups. And once they are comfortable, then they go through the login. Coming back to more serious business, EDX actually has a methodology, because EDX is a company, as I mentioned yesterday. So they have a methodology of selecting partners, which are universities. So here the methodology was just the ministry wrote to vice chancellors passed that paper to someone, and that is the reason why we got a feeling that the whole thing is sort of imposed from the top. In real world, in this is not the kind of thing that would happen. When I will start executing the larger project, extending this concept, I will be actually writing to university vice chancellors and several key people in those universities, asking them to consider joining this. It has to come from within. There is another aspect, and this is what I have learned from EDX. Apart from the universities, they actually go out and contact the best known teachers directly. Now, would you like to give a course? Would you like to give a course? Because the whole idea is to give the best to the students. And as you know, currently there is no recognition of the credits that is going to happen in the university, neither here nor in United States nor in Europe. It will take some time. So currently all that is happening is essentially a supplement to whatever students are studying. Okay. As I mentioned, the dropout rates are talked about, that only 10%, 15% finish. But as Professor Gaitonde said, it is not that the dropout is linear throughout the course. The large number of people registered, but on day one itself, a large number of them drop out. So it is not that they have seen something, they feel it is not good enough and then they drop out, but they drop out right at the beginning. So to begin with, the course starts with 20 to 25% people who register. And still 10 to 12% finish. So the gradient is, it is no different from when I start the semester, my class is full with 500 people. When I end the semester, the class has typically 50, 60 students. It is no different than that. And yet they learn something on their own, they give exams, whatever. So fundamentally, I am not worried about the so-called dropout rate and so on. Plus, statistics say that if only 10% of 1 lakh registered students finish, then that number is still 10,000, which is larger than what we can achieve. I mean, no teacher who is teaching the best course will get an opportunity to address 10,000 teachers, students who actually complete that. So these are the positive side. Now, I have given you the printouts of the EDX material. There are four documents there. Now, they talk about onboarding a new partner or onboarding university. There is a lot of American terminology which we'll have to translate into our British English. Onboarding means getting a new partner comfortable and arranging dialogue with that partner and helping that partner to identify courses, etc., etc. All subsequent documents then describe how do you provide, I think that it should be here somewhere. So, if you see this, there is a quick start guide, there is a university onboarding guide, there is a tactical course selection guide, and there is a guide to planning MOOC portfolio. I would like to inform you that this is all EDX copyright material, and that is the reason why I am not marking soft copies to you. But I have got permission from EDX to use this material for training purposes, and I will be using this material for this and probably one more workshop. We had actually planned, when our platform development project was approved, we had planned to conduct workshops, and a component of that planning was to create similar documents for Indian environment. You will all agree that it has to be done. Every new university, within the university, every new teacher, every new course, etc. We had planned to release this sometime in November or December, when would have run the first workshop. Unfortunately, as I said, for the first time in my life, events are overtaking me. I usually try to run ahead of events, but this time the government is too fast, which is a good problem to have, but that is the reason why we have these documents. My humble request to you is that you will of course carry these documents with you. They are meant to be given to you, so that is all legal. But if any one of you can think about making some modifications to these documents so that they become relevant and useful to us, that would be a very useful and important contribution. You see, unless I use crowdsourcing to the hilt, this will not take off with the same speed that we want. So we would like as many people to contribute as possible. We'll of course be putting up our team, but you will agree that next training workshop when we conduct, and it might have to be earlier than later, we should be having our own documents, which will, I could not give the name Swayam of course till it will be announced, but it will be like this, and these similar documents will be prepared. Now, are there any additional documents you think that should be prepared for circulation? Yeah.
So, when we are, for example, downloading something and trying to upload it on the Swayam site, the HTML tags which are there, and which I'm really thankful to Vrinda and Urmila for helping us out on and on again. So, based on their experience, if the sequencing can be kind of made it in a soft copy, in a documented form,
she wants to add something.
That would be really helpful.
I just wanted to add here is that actually we'll be having the technical support team, you know, so they will know these HTML tags and how to do the image and the, so that's what I was saying. That I think
the problem is at times we have to oversee the technical team as well, because the ultimate accountability rests with whoever is leading.
That is agreeable. I will tell you, I teach HTML, by the way, as a part of introductory course in programming, but when I need something, I go back to Vrinda. The fact of life is that we may get introduced to this, we may have a manual or something like that, but the speed with which we will be able to do things will be 1/10 of the speed of a technical expert. And it is not worth your time to spend on that activity.
Until we get the technical expert.
Oh, you can hire an HTML expert just outside your campus within 24 hours, absolutely. HTML experts are most easy to get. Don't look for bright programmers with BE degree and so on. They will in fact turn out to be like me, lousy HTML programmer. But you get college students who have done some HTML thing, BCA, Bachelor of Computer Application students. With little training, they will turn out to be good.
Sir, I have one suggestion for this. Why can't we use a Dreamweaver or front page as an interface instead of troubling with HTML and all those things, right? Our problem will be solved. Because she need not be worried about HTML and all those things.
So let me,
if it can be integrated with this, that will be great.
So let me tell you something. Just as you mentioned this, for last 6 months, we have been generating a whole lot of requirements that need to be integrated. This is not the only thing, because the idea is to make life as simple as possible. The point is that 250,000 lines of code resting upon a million lines of another open source code, you make one semicolon change somewhere and you have to go through a grill of 10 days of minimum testing of the whole thing. Now, that is what, by the way, so let me share with you the plan that I had proposed and it was approved. The plan was that after the project is approved, in 6 months, I will release the first beta version with some glimpses of the modified functionality that is required for Indian usage. And the first release was to happen by March end. Now, as I said, before that project was even approved formally, we have not yet received my money for that project. But we received a DO letter saying the project is approved, money will come. However, please start project activities with whatever money you have. Exactly like what the JS told all of your vice chancellors. Whatever money you have, you start using it. Money will come. So with this kind of speed, we are unable to do it. We took one very concrete decision. It may not be very useful right now, but that decision is, we have, by the way, two or three modified versions of this platform working in IIT itself. As I said, we are using a modified version for the blend and move. But we said we will not take chances. Because first time when you launch the site, and if there are 2 lakh students who register, they must not get any glitch in their operation. So it's a conscious decision that will not modify any platform feature at all. It's a very conscious decision. We'll keep all these requirements. We are piling up these requirements and your input is quite valuable. It will get recorded, of course, but do send a mail to us. And that is a request to all of you. You have played around with it. You have only a preliminary introduction. But over the next few days, you and your colleagues will actually do things. Every time you notice that this could be better or that could be better, do make it a point to send an email. We are going to compile all such requirements, then of course we will prioritize them, okay, and then we will be implementing. Our priority for this time was to try and give at least a Hindi version of the website, so that, because after all it's an Indian site, so English and Hindi minimum too. The second objective was to provide for a language choice so that I can choose Gujarati, Tamil, Telugu, anything tomorrow. We are also insisting that some of our courses which are ready are actually translated in Hindi. So the voiceover in Hindi is being recorded for some of our lectures, initial lectures as we speak. We are also adding Hindi explanation instead of English explanation, trying to give a dual feel for a course, that this course is available to both English speaking students as well as Hindi speaking students. Eventually, we would like, as I mentioned, there is a provision in the proposal that some of the more popular courses, particularly those meant for entry level college students or high school students, should be available in all Indian languages, and that will eventually happen. Now, the pages that you have got, this is the kind of activity that has to happen. I want to particularly draw your attention to one important activity, and that is filling up of the information about your university and about the courses. This is the most important form that you would have to fill up and submit. So this is the form or procedure for registration of a university or institute with the SWAYAM platform. Basically, this is a fairly elaborate document. A colleague of mine has actually translated it in Hindi just for the sake of form. So now you look at it this way. Take for example, SEAL logo or brand. Now, this SEAL logo or brand is not a printed thing that I want. I want an attachment, and I want an attachment with the RGB vector graphics on transparent background is preferred, because this is what will go into your site. So, in fact, all that we need from you is the basic information about university, information about courses, lead faculty, and the information about university should be at multiple levels. So there will be a if you go to EDX site, you will see how a university looks like. So there is a photograph describing that university, there is some write up about that university, exactly what you have played with. Now, how you would like your course and your university to be seen by millions of people. So for that, this has been created. This is fairly elaborate, and let me tell you, it would take, even if you have all these assets available, selecting and putting them together would take a minimum of one full day. So there will be a logo somewhere in the university, there will be a nice picture that you would like to reprint, whatever, whatever. The course teachers, collecting teachers' photograph, thanks to the technology, it's so easy to do that now. Okay, but it has to be done, and the logistics usually take some time. So while I agree that supply chain management is a bigger dada bhai of logistics management, but unless logistics is managed properly, supply chain cannot be managed. That you will agree, right? So here we are trying to ensure that you go back and manage the logistics. So for every new course, for example, the name of the university, starting date, end date, which will be roughly number of weeks that you would like to run the course for. Estimated time commitment per week is the time commitment that you expect from the student who does this. So it could be 5 hours a week, 8 hours a week, 3 hours a week, depends on how fast pace or slow pace you would like that course to be. The course faculty names, titles, faculty photos, a small biography text. If there is any FAQ about that course, so you may want to anticipate what questions will occur in students' mind about a course, and you may want to give them. There is a contact person from the university which is required, which for all purposes shall be the coordinator named by the university. So EDX calls it program manager. So like Kalpana is our program manager here, each coordinator is a pro, but coordinator is a better name in our environment, so we'll use the name coordinator. We'll be appointing a coordinator from our side who will be coordinating the law. Eventually, we'll be assigning, as the numbers increase, we'll be having a team of coordinators. So one coordinator for say 4 or 5 universities and so on. Now this is different. This is, what is the institute contact information if, for example, if there is a question about the course content. Because you see, each course that you submit, you create that course and you prepare that course. That course needs to be reviewed by IIT Bombay minimally for the following thing. Today it is IIT Bombay, tomorrow it will be a Section 8 company, or day after tomorrow Government of India, whatever it is. The idea is like this, while you will take all due precaution to ensure that the course contents are free of intellectual property right violation, there is a prudent requirement that it should be done independently as well. So in case there are any questions about any particular course content, then there has to be a person at your end who need not be the lead faculty or faculty member, but could be somebody else, or who could be one of the faculty members. But once that name is given, that means apart from designing the course and delivering the course, suppose I am the faculty and also named here, I have an additional responsibility to immediately respond to queries which come from the central place. If it says, for example, we believe that this particular page that you have put there is actually part of some book or paper published there, and we would like you to change it immediately. Now that change cannot happen after 10-12 days. It has to like happen immediately if that portion has been made public. So this kind of query can come any time during the execution of the course, and even during the design of the course if the design is well done ahead of time. For the first set of courses, I think there will be maramari. Maybe a few weeks of course material will be ready from each one. Even when you put the due date 4 months ahead, there will always be something that is happening. So it will be a dynamic thing, and that is why this person becomes more important. Now here the categories, see these categories are hard-coded. Hard-coded meaning there is a list in the database. So you cannot add a category by simply giving a course or giving a name. So what will be required? There is no code change that is required. But once you give a, suppose you suggest a subject for which there is no listed category here, then you will suggest a category and we will incorporate that category in the list of categories. Because these categories are also seen by students right up front. In fact, they can choose from the university, from the category, any course that they wish to register. So here are some examples given. For example, so the institute main banner image. So this is our banner image. This is our logo. Okay, this is a separate logo which is 200 by 101 pixels width and height. For the home page carousel, we give the logo in another site. This is a third site which is a private page logo image which will come somewhere else. For the course home page, we would expect you to design a graphic. It would be designed, of course, by, it could be decided by the lead faculty members in that faculty group, but it is useful to have such a design because this will appear on the list of courses right up the front page. So this is, for example, a design which was done by for Professor Gayatonde's course. The course listing image, that okay, this is the course page which will appear on the course itself when you go. This is the page which is a smaller size which will appear in the listing when you list all the courses. There is a course description page image where you would like to give something. There is a introductory video. You are all familiar with this thing, faculty photographs. And then just to help your coordinator to ensure that the participating teachers have given all the information, we have prepared a checklist. This is a, actually a standard military or government procedure that when you have to submit 10 documents, there is a checklist which you keep ticking that you have that document, you have that asset, so that something is not missed out. Sorry for being very elaborate, but we thought that it is best because we won't have time to interact with email saying ye nahi aaya, wo nahi aaya kind of thing. It is perfectly possible that in the first instance when you send everything, by chance something remains. Please don't wait. Send those with a cross mark here, but also announce that this will come within next 10 hours or 24 hours or whatever. We are actually running against time. That is the problem. This code number should be typically the code number for a subject that you give in your own university. Okay. In the global EDX context, there was always a doubt whether a university could give the same course title for global consumption. There could be issues about whether that course can be given by that university, has Senate approved it, whatever, whatever. These questions will arise here also. What EDX has done is they have decided that because they ultimately want actual university courses only to be offered. So they attach a word, a letter X called extended. So that means the course is same. So for example, our course is CS101.1X, ME209X. IIT Bombay itself is participating as IIT Bombay X, which is IIT Bombay's extension services. Because for example, when a student does a honor code certificate for any one of our courses, the certificate will be issued on the authority of our distance education program, the center for education, or it will be signed by the faculty members who teach that course. So university is sort of endorsing it, but sort of keeping it away. So university is not saying that this certificate entitles you to get any credits in my university or anywhere else. But university is saying, yes, this is a course which we offer to our students, it is being offered to you. It is not very clear to me whether we should say a course X or we just call the course as is. Any opinions on that?
On this issue of continuing with the .x provision for the launching the courses, I think this is a good idea because in university system, if you want to launch a course, We have to get it approved from the Board of Management and Academic Council, which is a long process. So probably if X provision is there, then it becomes simpler to.
By the way, I don't know whether you realize or not, but all of us today are taking decisions on behalf of the nation. There is no cross-check here. I don't need permission from the government now whether we should do it or not, because there is no time. And you know in your own processes, if you ask for permission, how long it takes for the deliberation and to decide whether permission is given or not. All my life I have worked in a style in which I am working now. Seek apologies later if required, but never ask for permission. Take a decision in good faith if it is taken, and if it is sensible to a large number of your colleagues, it is the correct decision. So we record this, that this is the decision taken by this body. It should be just as. What she is saying is that it is CS-101X currently, so it should be CS-101S. So there should be no dot, because the dot would be used later if you want to break a course or if you want to create versions of the course, then we would use that dot later. So is it all right? Typically, could a couple of you tell me how are the courses coded in your papers, code numbers, how they are given? Any example?
If we are offering in BSc honors course, then it is goes something like B. B stands for bachelor, P stands for physics, H stands for honors. So BPH 301T or 601T. So 6 corresponds to the semester.
Yeah. So something very similar will be there in most places.
Yes.
So do we then agree that we will simply add the letter capital S to any number that we have? That
the BHE example talks about a very long kind of nomenclature. So should we not restrict it to 3-4 characters or something?
I am not comfortable with that, because the I want students to identify with that course which is offered in BHU. If I change the course title or course number, then I will not be conveying the right spirit to the student. What I am trying to tell somebody in Kanyakumari is that when you register for this course, you will get to learn exactly what my BHU student gets to learn in Banaras. Now that I will be able to convey only if I say BB whatever whatever from BHU. Yeah.
There might be a small problem in some cases, because say the 5 IITs have similar master's degrees or BTech degrees.
Yes.
And they might have similar codings.
Yes.
So, differentiating between a course offered by say ISER Pune versus ISER Kolkata.
Correct. For example, there is a CS-101.
Right, also from
multiple places.
Right.
So, there are courses like that in almost all platforms which have exactly the same code number.
Correct.
But please remember that a course is also identified by the university which offers it.
Okay.
So, the
as long as both tags are there,
works. The best of my knowledge, ISER would not offer two courses with the same code.
Not the same ISER, but two different ISERs could
in the future. Yeah, that's okay. So ISER Pune, ISER Mohali, perfectly fine. So currently we'll go by that. So this is a decision I'm going to just convey to the ministry, that this is the decision we have taken. Also, I mentioned that whether you people like it or not, you actually become the first set of members of a loose consortium. The consortium has not yet been formally formed. Okay, new people will come in over the years. Some people may go out if they are inactive. So it is not a permanent representation just because of a historical accident, but because we all commit to continue to work and contribute. So over a period of time, we will develop our own rules and regulations. And once there is a consortium, that body will actually develop its rules and regulations. It is not uncommon to have fairly senior people representing the university to represent the university on such a consortium. So for example, many institutions or universities abroad have dean of distance learning or a position like we have our deputy director. So such people actually would represent the university in consortium meeting. typically they travel in pairs, the dean or deputy director along with the coordinator. Quite often in consortium meetings, you also have an associated event where latest developments on the platform, etc., are also discussed. So usually 3 to 4 people from a university may travel together. I propose that we shall have regularly at least one annual consortium meeting of this kind, and there could be 2 events per year at least in the first year. It is for this purpose that I have allocated a reasonable travel budget to every university. So I will just take 4 more minutes to just tell you about the budgets that we have proposed. I have the authority of the Joint Secretary to inform you that this is a commitment that the government is making. How long it will take to sanction our project and whether the money will be routed through IIT Bombay or it will be directly given, that's the thing that they will decide. I have already told you that the equipment budget is 2 crore rupees. 50 lakh rupees is the budget for the video equipment and the video editing desktops, etc., that you saw. So actually that video team will also accommodate people who will do transcription, transcript synchronization, etc. So I would expect a couple of video people or one camera person, one video person and one video editor to be there. I would expect the equivalent of Brinda and Urmila and 2 or 3 people like that. I would expect some other technical and assistant staff. I remember the numbers by heart, so I will tell you that. There was only one suggestion that was made yesterday, that in some places the power supply situation is very poor, and even if you have a battery which should ordinarily support the infrastructure, because which is not very big, and 40 kVA is a very fairly good UPS and the support, but there was a suggestion that we should provide for a diesel generator. Now my own feeling is that there was also simultaneously suggestion that the procurement of major equipment, if it could be done centrally, it could both speed up the process and it could help reduce the price.
We had some informal discussions amongst ourselves, and what we felt, at least I was more keen on that, is that unless IIT has developed some cloning technology, we cannot get Vrinda and them all over. So how best is that, let us have also a centralized uniform place where the staff are recruited and trained, and so that we get a team which is, you know, fairly good in quality.
So you are only partly right. Recruitment cannot be done centrally. You see, recruitment, the recruited people have to owe allegiance to you. If they are recruited centrally, they will owe allegiance to central place, not to you. You have to interview them, you have to select them, but we will provide extensive training.
Yeah.
We will provide extensive training to all your technical staff.
Yeah, training can be
whether
done
it is
for
video
that.
Staff, whether yeah. it is technical staff like Vrinda.
Yeah.
And absolutely have no doubt about it that they will be trained by their real experts, not by faculty members.
That's true.
So Vrinda and Urmila and others will train them on those aspects. Sajjan and his team will train them on the video aspect. So you know the famous saying, jeno kaam teno thai, bija kare to gota khai.
Yeah.
So if I try to train somebody on transcription or subunit and unit, mere saath aap bhi gota khayenge. So the recruitment, we have defined 5 categories of people. We have defined average salary. Say for example, the senior most person is pegged at 60,000 to 75,000 rupees per month. The junior most person is pegged at 15,000 to 25,000 rupees per month. These are consolidated salaries. These are temporary appointments. Typically, we recruit for 89 days. Immediately, within 1 day, we can make that appointment after an interview. If you find a person, if you advertise, which is the normal procedure, we have to appoint people for a 1 year duration, we have to advertise. That cycle typically takes 1.5 months. But in 1.5 months to 2 months, you can recruit people for 1 year, but you can recruit some staff immediately. Okay. The salary budget total is about 1 crore rupees per year per node. That is the budget we have kept.
I have also one more suggestion.
Sorry?
It means the person whatever you have categorized in 5 category. So what are the qualifications? So you must have fixed that.
So we have a set of categories defined, set of nomenclatures defined for different types of people, but of the same rank, what would be the nomenclature, etc. We have defined the typical qualifications and experience, and we have defined the range of salary. So that thing is available. It is a standard DNR&D's document circulated to all sponsored projects. You may have your own rules, but you can definitely use this and say that this is what has been recommended by IIT Bombay as being used in IIT Bombay. So you are most welcome.
Sir, I want to make a point.
Yeah.
Related to this issue, particularly within the universities. You said there are two options to fund this project, either through IIT or maybe directly the funds may be allocated to the university.
Yes.
But if it is given to the university, there are again two options, maybe in the form of a project or as a central budget grant of the university. If it is part of central budget grant, then it becomes very difficult to operate it independently. So project has to be implemented at sub-project level within the universities also.
Yes. I would be not comfortable with the money going into the university grant and then getting operated. To the best of my knowledge, it will not work properly. I don't know what your opinion is. The best bet is to run it under project mode. The way we handle it is, because we have handled projects where we have 3 or 4 university partners. Some of them are regular universities, some of them are institutions like IIT Bombay. What happens is that the project is approved to IIT Bombay. The money on a annual this thing is released to IIT Bombay. Within few days, we release that money to the principal investigator named for that project in that university. There are requirements of national mission when funds are released. An account has to be opened for that project. The account has to be always examined through the equivalent of CAG or audited. Expenditure has to be as per GFR. Now these are natural rules for all of you, but you have tremendous autonomy in controlling those funds rather than they disappearing in some central thing. That is at least our experience. And I would suggest that that is the best way. So what we do is we transfer that money, and all that you have to do is you have to keep submitting accounts on the regular interval that MHRD asks us. So we have to give utilization certificate at the end, and for partner institutions, they have to submit us the detail of the expenditure that they have. Okay. We generally do not ask any questions about why you have paid this salary to that person or something. That is your. I will tell you what are the problems with money. Let me just complete the grant here. So salary for about 20 staff is 100 lakhs. Mini cloud is about 150 lakhs, and I will see that by appropriate negotiations we can get even a diesel generator set wherever it is required. The MOOCs course creation lab is 50 lakhs. There is a consumable budget, an annual budget of 10 lakh rupees. I have seen people struggling to get even a ream of white paper for Xeroxing. As small thing as that. You must be completely independent of such things. There is a travel budget of 5 lakh rupees per year. This 5 lakh rupees per year travel budget is for you and your team members to attend the consortium meeting. This is not for sending your people for training programs to IIT. The training program travel budget is separately covered by IIT Bombay. So I have tried to be as reasonably liberal as is possible within the proceedings of the ministry so that your hands are not tied. There is a contingency budget of rupees 5 lakh per year. This contingency is at the discretion of the PI. Yeah.
We need to have some very good internet connection.
Huh.
And for that we need to identify vendor, and I think it could be good that if you at a central level
What I have been promised is that the IIT Bombay NKN connection is being upgraded to 10 Gbps precisely for supporting this, and those universities which are participating in this will get a 1 Gbps link from NKN.
Okay. What I suggest is that we need to have an independent off, because these networks don't work often. I think to run it successfully, because it's an online kind of a situation all the time, lot of time things don't work on a central level.
It is highly unlikely that the government will approve an independent network provision. Please note that in my entire project budget, there is no budget for the national cloud that is required, and there is no budget for the bandwidth. The proposal just mentions how it will be executed. Please also understand that you, in fact, would not require a humongous bandwidth. The students who are participating in the program and attending the classes or attending online courses, they will attend from wherever they are. You require a bandwidth to reach in a definitive fashion to the cloud, whether it is in IIT or in Delhi.
Okay.
And you do not require a huge bandwidth for that.
So that's what I wanted to clarify.
Yeah.
The course will not be shown or delivered from your university.
Correct.
The courses will come to a central cloud point, whether that is IIT Bombay now or the NME ICT cloud later. So you don't need that kind of, what you need bandwidth for, as Professor Fatak is saying, is to move everything over here or to interact with this place or something. That is for your testing and development.
That is for your own testing, and that is for offering courses to your own students on the campus, which you will do using local area network. In fact, the whole idea is that if I have 1,000 students in my university taking a course, then why should they be wasting their internet bandwidth to do that if the course is locally offered? So they should be able to do it. So this, actually the cloud infrastructure, I had thought a lot about it. By the way, I received a lot of flack in the committee. They think it is too much of an investment. But I told them that I believe that the universities which will participate will gradually move up the ladder and will start doing analytics of the data. We'll also start using it for local MOOCs courses, and therefore this is one occasion where each participating university should have it. So far they seem to be inclined to approve. So I think this we can, I have the commitment from the Joint Secretary himself that this budget will be approved for every part.
But sir, existing 1 Gbps links of NKN in the university like ours and University of Delhi, we have got, where we have 70 segregated colleges.
Correct.
And 54 departments, and we have almost 5,000 nodes working. So that is already being overloaded, and at times we do not get desired speed.
Yes.
So if we are putting this again, then again we have some problems.
What I can do at best is take this request to the ministry, saying that the universities which have overloaded network bandwidth should be provided with additional bandwidth. But the decision is beyond the scope of the project for the massive operation. Because frankly speaking, if somebody, some auditor like person goes into the details, say kitna bandwidth chahiye tumko, वो कोर्स उधर से इधर लोड करने का है. कोर्स चालू होने वाला कब है? नवंबर में. अभी लोड करता है वो, नहीं हुआ 5 सेकंड में, रात भर में हो जाएगा. व्हाट्स योर प्रॉब्लम? दिस आर द काइंड ऑफ क्वेश्चन विच आर लाइकली टू बी आस्क्ड इफ पीपल गो इनटू द डिटेल्स ऑफ व्हाई द बैंडविड्थ इज बीइंग डिमांडेड.
सो फॉर दिस MOOCs प्रोजेक्ट अलोन आई जस्ट डू नॉट सी एडिशनल बैंडविड्थ बीइंग सैंक्शनड, especially to Delhi University, whose situation is well known. You have private service providers as backup and everything. You really don't need any more bandwidth just for this. You may need it for all your connectivity, not for this.
The bandwidth is a commodity which is perpetually choked, no matter how much you do. It's like this space. We started with 7.25 megabyte capacity disk. Today we have a terabyte disk. And this disk is as full as that disk was in 1974, so no difference. Anyway, but let us not waste time.
I'll come again to the budget part.
Yeah.
Being a teacher of economics, I'll come to again the budget part. It's regarding the honorarium to the teachers who will be contributing to the...
There is a course creation budget of 20 lakh rupees.
For one course.
For one course. it is video clips, transcription, synchronization, online quizzes, tests, practice problem, handout, course material, everything that is created. The payment norms will be, we will be circulating the payment norms which are approved here. Even here we are trying to get norms approved because so far nobody had done any kind of move. You see, we have a peculiar problem. We have Kannan and I do not take a single paisa honorarium from any MHRD project for any activity. That is just to show our commitment. However, normal people need to be respected for the time that they spent and an honorarium has to be given. Now, when other faculty members will start taking courses, this honorarium question will come. We have a regular definition of this honorarium. It is typically based on the estimate of the amount of time that the teachers have to spend. But the honorarium, I believe, is fairly sumptuous. It is typically, I think, 2 lakh rupees per faculty member for a course of one semester duration. Additional money to be paid to teaching assistants and others, or a person who is employed by that teacher to support that person, etc. Please note that there is an overriding clause in the national mission thing that any honorarium paid to an individual cannot exceed 20% of the annual salary of that person. Cap of 3 months of salary. This is the stupidest ever rule I have seen, but this rule prevails. We had similar rules. For example, consultancy earning could not be greater than the annual salary of a professor in IIT Bombay. For decades, this was the rule. When I was on the IRCC, I argued that suppose a company wishes to pay 1 crore rupee per day for a faculty member's time. What is your problem? You will get a larger chunk for that faculty time. You decide how much time a faculty member should spend. That is decided by the institute norm, which says every faculty member can spend 1 day a week on consulting. How much that day should cost should be decided by the market forces. You are an economic professor, so you would know that. Fortunately, IIT Bombay, like other IITs, have made that. Now there is no upper cap, but government funding and government honorarium has such upper cap. What we have tried to do therefore is that to operate within the caps, but to make the life of the teacher and the group of teachers comfortable, we are saying there is money, but please use that money to hire assistants, pay to your students, pay to others and get them to contribute. However, the honorarium is not very unreasonable is what I would say.
Yeah. The thing is that yesterday we had a talk about centralized procurement.
Yeah.
So you said that you are considering that very seriously because each individual have a lot of red tapes and bottlenecks in procurement, like open tender and all.
That's right.
Which can drag on to up to, it has to be floated on the website, on the newspapers. Right. So it can drag simple purchases and appointments also, it, particularly purchases of hardware can drag to 3-4 months.
Yes.
So since we have to kickstart this program, it will be back initially at least to do some sort of a central procurement, ask the vendor to go and install the equipment.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And once we are satisfied, the guy over there on the faculty will sign off.
We have done that kind of thing earlier and we plan to do that. That was a suggestion made earlier and we will be doing that. It's not a problem.
Yeah, thank you.
I think we should break.